Tonight on Life on the Rock, we have the Rome Boys Part 1. We'll see one of their videos and much more. Welcome to Life on the Rock. Tonight, our guests are the Rome Boys. These are three normal guys, married, kids, and they have a great YouTube channel and podcast and social media outreach, all kinds of outreach about the Catholic faith. They're going to share about their show, their own personal faith and lives tonight. And right now, we're going to show you a quick clip from the Rome Boys.
Welcome back to Rome Boys.
Oh, here we go.
Welcome to the Rome Boys channel.
Hi, I'm Tony, the theologian.
I'm Joe, the farmer.
And I'm Chris, the entrepreneur.
Welcome to our page as we try to spread the gospel and evangelize and kind of get out there in the world and spread the good news.
And we're on Facebook, LinkedIn, Twitter, and Instagram, so check us out there.
We came together to share the gospel and join in the discussion. We hope you'll join us.
So in the meantime,
be bold,
be real,
be Catholic.
God bless.
Rome Boys, welcome to Life on the Rock.
Thanks so much,
Father Mark.
We have Chris Martin, Joe Matthiesen, and Tony Frasco.
Yes.
So tell us, give our viewers a thumbnail of what is Rome Boys. Maybe talk about the YouTube.
Well, it's basically a YouTube channel that we kind of put together just to kind of discuss the faith from three different perspectives. You got Tony the teacher, Joe the farmer, and Chris the businessman entrepreneur. So it's three different worldly perspectives on our one holy Catholic faith.
And I'm a cradle Catholic, and Joe's
kind of the same, but the revert over time, and then we got the convert.
Wow. Yes.
And so, and some of the things you do, so you have the YouTube channel, you got the podcast, you give talks. Tell us about the talks you give.
Oh, the talks are the best. You know, we enjoy being behind a camera, but being able to be with people who are dealing with the same stuff that we are. It's a blessing and an honor, and of course we always feel the energy from the people who get to receive what we hope is God's message. We've done parish missions and spoke about different topics about our faith, and sometimes people ask us to talk about ourselves, which isn't always easy, right? Yeah. But
I don't know, isn't it always easy to talk about yourself? Comfortable behind a camera? I'm not so sure. I mean, our first episode was a bomb.
Yes.
It was terrible.
Yes.
I remember standing there, "Hi, I'm Joe. We want to talk about Jesus."
Yeah.
You know, it was just terrible. So that would never
live and learn.
Yeah. What are your favorite shows? Like, maybe most popular favorite? What's one?
Well, interviewing some of the most people that you look up to the most, you know, Father Calloway interviewing an exorcist. I mean, like, those are crazy stories to be able to talk to people that are, you know, highlights of the Catholic faith, people that you look up to and role models. But really, the Faith Formation series is, I think, our bread and butter. We're RCIA teachers, so, you know, teaching about the faith from the catechism.
You met teaching RCIA.
Exactly, yeah. Chris and I are brothers-in-laws, and we all are on the same team as far as RCIA goes. And, yeah, just really getting into the heart of evangelization and catechesis, because there's such a lack, there's such a need for that. In our diocese and all throughout the world, right? I mean, you talked about before, like, and myself too, so uncatechized. I went to Catholic grade school, Catholic high school, and really wasn't told about the real presence of the Eucharist. And it wasn't until Totus Tuus, when I taught for that program, that I really fell in love with the Eucharist. So we need to inspire people to know those things. And so each of the topics in the Faith Formation series will cover everything in the Catechism. So if somebody watches all those, they'll know the nuts and bolts of our faith.
Well, when I was a kid, my favorite show was Little House on the Prairie. But as I grew up, your question was, what's your favorite show?
Yeah. So you're out in West Texas.
Our show. Yeah.
You're out in West Texas.
We are.
San Angelo.
By choice.
By choice.
Yeah.
They're by choice.
By God's call. Yeah.
Them by choice. My family, I'm a fifth generation farmer out there, so yeah, I had no choice.
And the Faith Formation program would be like just you guys talking about a particular faith topic on your YouTube channel.
We were inspired by actually the diocese said, hey, you guys do it. They saw what we were doing and said, it wouldn't be a bad idea to produce some content for not just the local parish, you know, for RCIA, but our youth programs and such. And so we feel like that's an ongoing project. But once we have the basics of the faith out there, we'd like to package it, you know, and make sure that people get to see it from what we consider just a normal average Joe perspective.
Yeah. Right. And speaking of Joe, he does an excellent job adding clips and then different things throughout the video to keep people's attention. Because lots of times the talk can go on for an hour and people lose interest, right, especially in this day and age. So right, every couple of minutes he's hitting us with something funny, you know, right, something to engage
just
the person.
Kind of keep you awake.
Mm-hmm. I thought it was interesting how y'all go into some of your churches in the diocese or in the area, mm-hmm, and just talk about the stained glass, talk about maybe the history of it. I think that's so powerful because, I mean, that's a product of like people's real faith to build that church, to design it, and it represents a people.
Well, some of those churches are just 100 years old, mm-hmm, you know, or older, and they were built by the parishioners. Mm-hmm. You know, the church in our area that burned down in the 30s, and then by, you know, just a few months later, the whole structure without forklifts, cranes, scaffolding, I mean, they just did it with their own bare hands, and they're, mm-hmm, still standing. And there's a lot of churches in South Texas, they call them the painted churches, and they're tourists, that people come to see them all the time. And
y'all done some of those churches?
I haven't been there yet. Like, we've seen them personally, okay, but not, yeah, actually done a video
done
on
a
them.
Yeah.
But our stained glass windows, we think, are kind of our painted churches.
Mm-hmm. We want to encourage people to go to these beautiful churches, and at the same time, we want to interview amazing guests that people can look up to, and amazing, really great Catholic priests, too.
Right.
Solid Catholic priests that are Orthodox to give people hope, you know, and give them joy. You know, you walk, right, into the church, wow, you hear this interview of this priest, oh my goodness, like, okay, there is young priests that are solid, that love the faith. So we want to always be encouraging and always bring joy as our definitely our mission.
Absolutely.
And for this first show, we wanted to talk about like who you are personally. I think a huge part of you guys' identity is you guys have the credibility of married with kids, working full time. It's incredible. Tony, you have 7 kids.
Yes, yes.
And now you're doing full-time Rome Boys.
Yeah, full-time Rome Boys, full-time homeschooling. I don't know how you can do full-time 2 things at the same time. I can't be Padre Pio, my favorite saint, by locate yet. Yeah. But yes, married with 7 kids, most amazing wife in the world. Sorry, guys. It's amazing to be able to raise, you know, 4 boys and 3 girls and see the variety and the different types of learners, because I'm a homeschool dad, and just their different interests, and always encouraging them in the vocation that God calls them to. So, yes, if you're called to be married, please revolutionize marriage. You know, let's be radical saints for that. If you're called to religious life, to diocesan priesthood, whatever it may be, we need all in solid Catholics in whatever you may do. Mm. And one statistic that we mentioned lots of times is, you know, the majority, if Catholic families are talking about the Catholic faith on an everyday basis, in a real way, in a bold way, those kids are more likely to remain Catholic the rest of their life. So in the Frasco household, we talk about everything all the time, and we're homeschooling even at midnight, you know, and just whatever, you know, it's just life, and it's messy. And if you came over to my house, it's crazy, and it's loud.
Right.
But at the same time, it's we're trying our best to raise up saints.
Right. And Chris, you were in healthcare. Tell us about that work.
I never thought I would have even had the ability to step in that realm. You know, the only person in my family, besides my uncle, to go to college. And so what I saw, I work in nursing homes, and what I saw was a people that are forgotten. You know, 65% of people in nursing homes have no living relatives. Nobody, no kids, no grandkids, no siblings, and they're often forgotten. And there's many organizations, companies in the nursing home space that it seems as if the owners are just more worried about the bottom line. And the leaders in
this— Did you own a few nursing homes?
I do, yeah. I can't believe I can say that honestly, but I have a great business partner who's my cousin-in-law. And we do own nursing homes.
I'm going to have to cut you there. We'll take a quick break, but we'll come back to your story and hear more about that. So back in a moment. Well, Chris, you have six daughters, and you own a number of nursing homes, and you were telling us about the great need for that.
Yeah, it's just incredible how much we become family with these people, because they have nobody, and they have no one. And the nurse aides and the housekeepers and all of the resources and the people that it takes to take care of them is, it was an opportunity for me to give back. I was, the day before I was to sign up to go to the Army, my friend was with me. We were spending the night together. At 4 o'clock in the morning, I said no, I backed out. And he retired from the military after 20 years. And that always hurt and left an empty spot in my heart to serve this country and serve the people who have paved the roads before us. And while it might sound cliche, it was true. I felt that I had a calling to serve the community in a bigger way. And it's been a great experience, and I always believe I can do more, and I'm excited for what the future holds. But
and to me, I see that, like, with the breakdown of marriage, less people getting married, having kids, you're going to have more people isolated, and it might be through, yes, no fault of their own, you know, but they're in this situation. So that's such a obvious corporal, spiritual work of mercy.
Indeed. And I have those up on my office. And yeah. So when some of the staff or visitors or anyone comes in and sees that, they've never seen it before. And it really hits home with them. And I use that in my daily life to bring my faith into the workplace. Not in a pushy way, just living out those works of mercy and just the basic tenets of our faith. So,
yeah, that's such a work of charity, and you have more red tape in that profession than nuclear power, right?
Yeah, 2011.
It'd be easier to start a nuclear power plant.
Yeah, that's what they say. Yeah, 2011, we passed up nuclear power to have more regulations, and so. When people are frustrated with their job or with, you know, a policy or this and that and the other, we have to be there and still spread joy and bring the joy of Christ to everyday situations. It's quite simple. It's not easy.
When you started talking about nuclear power, I thought you were talking about some of the food y'all served.
Oh, it's okay. No, actually, we have great cooks.
Now, you have an incredible story, right? You actually had a dirt floor in your home growing up for a while.
Yeah, not many people do. It's a rare thing, you know. It's everybody's doing it. No, early on, I you know, when
not
I tell
part of the green movement, but
no, it was very brown. But it's one of my oldest memories. Some people talk about their fondest. My oldest memory was sleeping on a dirt floor as a child. My mom has had a rough life. And when she was 14, her dad died, and she was a middle child and a daddy's girl, and she was pregnant with me at 16 years old and had me when she was 17 and didn't graduate high school. She was head cheerleader, had her whole life ahead of her. Mm-hmm. And she was in a dark place, in a rough spot, and alcohol played a big part of that, and drugs. And so as a child, I was, you know, I saw a lot of things that children should not see. Mm-hmm. And I love my mother. I love her to this day. We talk every day. Honestly, it's been a great experience. And
I imagine it's given you a sensitivity to people that are hurting.
That I couldn't possibly say it a better way. Seeking to understand where others are coming from. And it's interesting because in my role, in my job, and over the past 15 years, I think a lot of people don't expect to know where I've come from when they see me. And I've got a college degree, I'm a professional, but then when we get to actually relate in difficult situations.
You did some graduate work at Cornell.
Yeah, so.
From West Texas.
Yeah, right. So, but you know, it's those moments, you know, to your point, where we just gotta be ourselves, we gotta be real, we gotta be who God calls us to be, no matter what.
Yeah.
No matter what, right? It sounds so cliche and simple, but man, it's tough at times.
Yeah. Now, Joe, you're the farmer, cotton farmer in Texas. Mm-hmm. You got five kids. You're doing all this. How's that possibly happen?
It's probably the most common question that I get is, where do you find time for all this? Where do you find time? Well, the drought helps. Right now, we're going through a tremendous drought in West Texas, so I have a little time on my hands, but really, I couldn't do it without the support of my wife, She's just amazing and supports me and actually wrangles the kids so that we can find time to record these episodes and do these things. And it's hard on her. It really is hard, but without her support, there's no way I can do it. And then my parents are tremendous help. My dad, just whenever I'm gone, he's getting to that retirement age or already kind of semi-retired, and he picks up the load and gets back to work for me so that I can go do these things and help spread the gospel. And, I believe it was Romans 10 that talks about, blessed are those who are sent. Mm-hmm. Well, blessed are those who send them. So, and then my parents, my dad, and my wife, those are the ones that are sending us. And
you're a cradle Catholic.
Grew up always been cradle Catholic. I've had a pretty good Catholic lineage growing up. Had a great uncle who was a bishop, great uncle who was a Monsignor, a great aunt who was a nun, Benedictine nun in Florida. My brother became a priest. My grandfather was in the seminary. I'm so thankful he got out. just Catholicism was very family tradition, really. Right. For me, it was anyway. And so it took a little time for me to pick it up. And it was really when my kids' faith was dependent on mine is when it became really important to me, and that's when I just couldn't stop. And it was just had to learn more and more, and studying was not my thing. It just God has his ways of breaking in when it's his time. So.
And you have the tagline of "Be real."
Right.
Is that connected to the farming? Because farmers live in reality. You need rain. You need.
Yeah, I have a sign in my office that says we don't believe in miracles. We rely upon them. Farming. We get down and dirty. Kind of the nuts and bolts. And we try to target the men. And that's how we operate. This is the way it is. This is how it goes. That's kind of what I bring to the table is just the practicality of it all. It's like, this is how it works. Can't argue with that.
Right.
You can't argue with the
truth. Right. So we just got like 30 seconds. But we're gonna do a second show with you all. We're going to talk more about the content of your show and some of your favorite topics and themes. So you want to be sure and catch us next week. And thanks so much for joining us.
Thanks for having us. This is great.
And now for our Into the Vineyard segment. Brother John is doing some of the facilities blessings today, so he couldn't be here for the show. So I thought we'd bring Joe on for this segment. And one of the points I like about the show is some of you have family connections, but you largely connected through RCIA, that was important to you to help form others in the faith. Talk about that early motivation for you.
Well, our cluster parishes, we have three parishes. Our priest, Father Ariel, has all three of them and takes care of those for us. And we have a unique dynamic for our RCIA classes. It's a team effort. So we have Deacon Allen and Chris, who are our head RCIA team. And then we have several speakers, and myself and Tony included, that come in and just pick a topic, or topics are kind of chosen for us sometimes. Mm-hmm. But so we just come in and we speak on that once a week. So you don't have the same person talking every week.
And it's kind of like a show.
Yeah, more or less, yeah.
So kind of continued that process.
Yeah, the three of us have actually done an RCIA class together and made a show out of it. So it's been a lot of fun doing that. But, so we met through that and we kind of gotten to know each other. We had a lot in common with a lot of kids and our wives being homeschool moms and just had a lot in common.
Right.
But there was always this desire to do something more, something that we could reach our age group, because there's lots of stuff out there for kids. There's lots of stuff out there for the older adults.
Yeah.
But for our age group, there's not a whole lot. So we were just trying to reach them. But our stage of life is chasing kids, and it's hard to find the time to be able to do that kind of stuff. So.
And that's a huge part of your story. We heard that tonight about the strong family unit, the support of their wives. Thumbnail, how'd you meet this incredible woman?
My goodness, at a Catholic wedding. She was a little Baptist girl from, she had to be out of the county because I'm related to pretty much everybody in my county. So met her at a wedding right in my backyard, and just kind of she had wanted nothing to do with me, but I'm she said she fell in love with my persistence. So
really?
Yeah, so.
And she converted?
She converted shortly after we were married, when we were starting to have a family. She converted to become, you know, so we could all go to the same church. Mm-hmm. Well, when I had my reversion, I was sharing a lot of things that I was learning, and the scales fell from our both of our eyes, and she converted. She's a stronger Catholic than I am. You go to our house and it looks like a church, you know. Our kids tease that, you know, we have pictures of saints on our walls instead of the kids. So you have to be a saint to make it on our walls, what they say. So, yeah.
Well, again, Joe, thank you so much for joining us. And we hope this show has inspired you at home, especially like Ben out there, the greatness of family life and the greatness of God's call and mission for you. May our Heavenly Father shine His face upon you. May He give you His peace. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. We'll see you next week on Life on the Rock.
Early in the morning, as I journey to tomb, there was nowhere else to go. With eyes full of tears, and when He spoke my name, we were standing face to face. And I have seen the Lord, I have seen the Lord. He's no longer dead. By the saving grace of God, it is Christ who changed my life. And I have seen the Lord.